in order to get anything to happen, you have to take a certain amount of risk, and you have to sort of go into an area where you're not sure you're going to be able to pull it off.
George is always known as an innovator. Here we go again. He's doing something new. He's doing something different.
It certainly is it's a risk. It's a risky idea.
The quality of an image that's captured on a digital camera does not stand up against the same image that would be captured on a piece of motion picture film.
When you're shooting a film, it's like doing beautiful art, you know, traditional art. Video today is still modern art, not even good modern art yet.
There is a lot of controversy about the fact that we're shooting this digitally. As far as I'm concerned, they should have been shooting digital cinema 20 years ago. People say, why am I doing it? I say, you know, the real question is, why not?
Well, the very first time that George ever discussed his concept of a digital future for the cinema and television was in 1989. And I'm even amazed now how precise that vision actually was about what he wanted to achieve. First of all, there was a series, Young Indiana Jones. He wanted to make that a test bed for digital effects.
On the Young Indiana Jones Chronicles, which was shot on 16mm, by the way, George was already tampering with digital additions, digital extensions, and replication. That series was really the test of digital technology.
George wanted to fold the technology that we had developed on Young Indy and try and do the same thing in a feature film called Radioland Murders.
He was curious to see if it was possible to do the same thing on 35mm and project it onto a big screen.
No one had a problem in terms of the effects. In fact, they're imperceptible. Even though the film wasn't successful, that part of the process was incredibly successful for us.
So George had the confidence to use that same technology in The Phantom Menace.
Stand on, let's go.
And then we've gone one stage further in episode 2, actually shooting on digital.
For the kind of films that George makes, the kind of films that we make, we are ostensibly in the digital arena from the first day that we actually start working. Most people fail to realize this, but basically what happens is every single frame, every single shot in the movie has a digital effect.
Pretty much every set has blue screen, even if it's just out a window or something.
It's everywhere. I think I've been on one set where there hasn't been any blue screen.
So for us to shoot and film and then scan it into a computer is a ridiculous process. Right now, we can shoot on high def, and 50 minutes after we shoot a 50-minute cassette, it's inside the computer.
Well, yes, this is the day shooting. There's no more laboratory. It's now on tape. Sound and picture on the same recording device, sunk automatically for us to put in on the computers. It's all on this one thing.
We wanted to shoot the last film this way, and had been working with Sony for several years to try to make it happen, and just couldn't get the cameras built fast enough.
There were certain inherent basic issues. Video is shot at 30 frames per second, film is shot at 24 frames per second, and that was a major holdback for us.
The biggest difference with these cameras is that they were developed to provide a 24 frame per second frame rate, which is exactly the rate that we've been using for production photography and film.
So it means that when they scan it onto film, you have one video frame to every film frame.
The next big problem that we had was, of course, not just the camera, but the lenses. The lenses that come with the camera were not acceptable to acquire this widescreen format that we shoot. So the only place I could go to then was Panavision.
Yeah, they're computer design lenses, focusing on a very small target.
The actual chips that are in the camera are smaller than a 35 millimeter film image. That meant the performance of the lens actually had to be better than a 35 millimeter lens, since you were using a smaller area to image the entire high resolution frame on.
The depth of field, the clarity, the sharpness of the image, the brightness was something that still just knocked us off our feet.
There's never any doubt about whether or not you can see something in the background, or you will see something in the background. It's exactly how it's going to be on the big screen.
The cameraman, the prop department, wardrobe, hair, myself, everybody gets to see the dailies, everybody gets to see if anything's wrong, and they get to fix it by the next take. Whereas normally you wait until the next day and then you have to go back and reshoot it.
Oh,
The mobility of the film camera is still better than digital. I could move the Nariflex, move all over the world, go all over the mountains with any temperature and shoot.
We spent years in the film industry trying to get the camera free. Now suddenly we're tied to cables again.
On this show, we've got to plug 7 cables into the camera. An HD, a time code, a gen lock, 2 audios, and data.
The camera, to be honest, does feel a bit cumbersome. It's pretty long, it's unwieldy. But already, you know, even since we started, they've made a new zoom lens. It's half the size, half the weight. And next year, the camera's going to be half the size.
I am sure it will improve eventually. It's digital is work in progress.
It's breathing down the neck of the film camera.
It doesn't mean that technology is going to make the film any better. That has nothing to do with art.
Technology is used to tell a story, and that's the whole point. It's really the filmmaker and the storyteller and how well they're able to tell the story that counts in the end. The techniques they use are really a byproduct of that.
Thanks, folks. First up in the morning, the other pod will come in. We'll take the grey pod out tonight.
Jeds.
And we'll start with scene 5.
Can we get the charts in?
So that's a wrap.
What you do is you go where the story takes you. I mean, you really sort of, sometimes you have to be on location because it just demands it. When I did Star Wars, I had to come up with environments. You know, if you think of outer space and you think of other planets, they're all basically deserts. So that was a natural.
To be able to go, you know, 25 years ago in the middle of the desert and take this English crew and movement of that was bold, and it was also foolhardy, and it worked.
I thought we were crazy.
Yeah. I thought you were crazy.
Well, everybody did.
Yeah.
But that's all right. I'm happy now. The most difficult and challenging location was in Norway, Finsko, the Hoth ice planet. We ran into, blizzards and whiteouts and all kinds of things that slowed down the production, stopped it for days on end. You know, we didn't go to Norway to go skiing, and, you know, we didn't go to the desert to get a suntan, and, you know, it's like, basically, you're trying to get the work done.
That was a different era in filmmaking history then. In those days, virtually everything had to be built physically, whereas we have much more flexibility now in the digital arena.
We're getting closer and closer to where we have to shoot less and less on location.
When we were doing episode 2, we were going to Italy for less than a week. We were going to Spain for less than a week. Tunisia just over a week. England just over a week. It becomes a really interesting challenge in terms of the movement of people, the feeding of them, making sure that they're taken care of.
We are arriving to Trevagiare. Ah!
Ciao, ragazzi.
No worries.
Most filmmakers would rather be able to focus on the work at hand and not have to deal with how do you get there and what the elements are like when you're there.
It's 10 o'clock, and I just want to shoot and get started. I don't like getting my first shot off this late.
No.
I was scouting locations as I was on my vacation, and I knew I had a scene that took place in some villa someplace in a beautiful part of the countryside that was extremely romantic. I had the exact location, but I didn't have the exact scene.
I saw a picture of Lake Como, one of the locations in Italy. It's just almost surrealistic. It looks like it belongs in Star Wars. And before this, I've never been outside of North America, so it's my way of seeing the world a little bit right now, too.
I think the thing I enjoy about locations in general is just the feeling that you're not in control, you know, that anything can happen. The case with the rain is you look at George, he looks at you. We're in a digital environment. You have such control over every single frame. We looked at each other and said, hey.
It's God's way of describing the scene.
It could be worse. It could be snowing.
Tomorrow we go to Tunisia.
Mexico.
Africa. Desert. Very hot.
And action!
action!
Just think, 24 years ago, I vowed never to return to this awful planet. And here I am, doing it again.
We seem to be made to suffer.
It's our lot in life.
I know a few of the actors who would rather not be out here. It hasn't changed too much. It's our little funky set.
All the little set pieces have been rebuilt, but these are the original earthen craters that were there before.
It's going back to the homestead, obviously, it's like going back to where you grew up. You know, it's a little weird, and it's a little nostalgic, and, you know, there's a certain amount of emotion that goes with being back at a place you were, you know, 25 years before.
Beautiful.
I'm getting spine tingles.
I bet.
You know, the most telling moment this morning was when I saw one of the moisture evaporators.
Full reunion.
The evaporators kept falling over in the middle of a take, which was kind of embarrassing. Then in the middle of a take, you know, bits of my costume would fall off. The Jawas would start crying.
All right, let's try one more a little bit faster.
Almost any location I've shot on, I've been able to get material that I just couldn't get in a studio, or it would take a very long time to recreate digitally.
The more real things you can get in your image, the more believable those images are, and you just have to sort of tweak them sort of on set or in post-production.
All the environments that we're shooting, I've always intended to digitally change so they don't look quite as they are in real life.
Technologically, we're in areas that most people won't get to for another 3 or 4 or 5 years, and we're always on the bleeding edge of it.
With digital technology the way it is, we can recreate a lot of the vastness and the big parts of the location digitally.
And action.
So, George, why are you shooting a shot for episode 3?
I can't tell you that. You have to wait 6 years for that answer.
6 years.
How much stuff are you doing for episode 3 now?
Just this one shot. Oh. It means that now I don't have to come back here. So it's a long way to come and bring a crew of 60 people just to shoot one shot. And then rebuild the set and all the other stuff we have to do in 3 years.
What happens if you decide you want another shot?
I don't get it.
In Star Wars, in any of the episodes that we're making, extras are extraordinarily important in defining the place that we're at. To, you know, have people understand that there was another world there.
I don't know how we ended up here.
And where planet are you from?
Sydney.
There are sequences in Star Wars like the Cantina where I think that's certainly my favorite sequence, and that's entirely made up of extras, and it turned out to be one of the best in the whole saga.
Extras seem to have very high self-esteem, I think, because they're put through so much during the day. They're herded around like cattle.
Get on the bus! Get on the bus!
They don't do anything for hours at a time, so you have to really feel good about yourself.
I'm a spaceman, but a very important spaceman.
As an ordinary extra, I say you're not a star, but you're a twinkle beyond Pluto.
Can we boogie?
The response for Star Wars has been like no other production I've ever worked on, because people know it and they love it and they're dedicated to it and they're fans. It's so different working on a project that has so much history.
The Ewoks.
The Ewoks.
Yeah.
Why did you remember that one?
Oh, because I didn't get the pack.
I've seen every Star Wars film in the first week it was out, and I just can't believe I'm here.
Stroke of luck, really.
The Force was with us.
I know. The reaction, particularly with younger people, when you just casually mention, oh, I've done a couple of days in Star Wars. Star Wars!
I know, yes. Yes, indeed.
I'm getting ready for my
part as an intergalactic backpacker.
You're all normal pedestrian.
An extra is someone who is in the background of a scene who has no dialogue but may have a little bit of business.
You go in the direction I told you to go as I walked along the side.
You're an animated body.
An animated body, a screen filler.
Said, folks, just pick it up a bit, just be a bit animated. Just because you're in space doesn't mean that you can't have fun.
You'll see that this is actually all fogged up, so it's impossible to see out of any of this, but I mean, that's the fun of acting, really, isn't it?
We actually don't need an acting ability.
You're always going to be doing the same thing.
What we need is a look.
Basically, what we want to do is try and fit the faces of the particular extras into costumes which would suit their own little characters.
You sort of can't just have a costume allotted for people because we're getting all different shapes and sizes.
I can't see where he's moving the lightsabers.
Jedis don't have to see.
Got it?
When you finish your schooling, you'll look like Ewan McGregor. Lots of facial hair, tall.
Everybody falls for the strong, silent type.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I guess
that's you, right?
Yeah!
Every creature and every extra that you see in each movie has a name, has a personality, has a backstory. They are some sort of being that has actually been given a life. There's one in episode 2. His name is Kit Fisto. Just an extra, a guy, but all of a sudden, like, put in his name, and now there's the story there. Like, you want to know something about him.
I love it. Shoot it.
When this goes on, I'm a totally different person. I'm female. Easy.
We have a sequence in episode 2 where we're in a nightclub.
Yo, I got a really good date for you.
Surprise.
I fixed you up. Here she is.
Horror.
Come here. Put your arm around Tony here. There you go.
It's a very classic Western type of barroom scene where the doors fly open and the two gunslingers walk in.
We needed about 150 extras. There had to be a certain look to them.
I've never looked like this before.
I have been airbrushed all over.
It's a place that's in the lower depths of Coruscant, a place that we actually haven't really seen before.
There is one thing worse than working with me, it's being an extra in a Star Wars movie, is okay?
And I would debate that.
So when we come around to that second
and you have a great first assistant director who can move his extras around. Ah, it's fantastic.
Everyone take a step to their right.
There's two rules. First rule is, I don't care what you do. I don't care where you go. I don't care if you need to buy a paper, go to the bathroom, whatever. But the second rule is, you got to tell me you're going to do it.
You guys just stepped off set. What happened?
Stand-ins are slightly higher in status than extras. Perhaps when you're standing in the queue at lunchtime, you can stand in front of someone who's an extra.
We are indebted to you for your bravery, Obi-Wan Kenobi.
In episode 1, there's a scene, a particularly beautiful, haunting, and dramatic scene, where there are two extras who I think basically define what extra acting is all about.
Congratulations on your election, Chancellor.
That happens to be Ben Burtt and myself in this sequence. Classic example for anyone that anyone can be an extra, but they can do it a lot better than we did.
Thank you guys. Really appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you so much.
When I did Star Wars, the whole project was an exercise in reining myself in and designing a film to be able to get the maximum amount of strange environment and exciting spaceship action out of very, very little. I don't really have to rein myself in anymore.
Welcome to episode 2.
Roll, please.
Action! I would say over half the sets are digitally created.
That was great.
It's in essence a digital movie, so that ILM is really working on every single shot.
In general, George doesn't limit his thinking to what he knows can be done with the technology. He always tries to set the bar a little higher, and it's up to us to try and figure out, well, can that actually be executed?
You know, film is a very collaborative medium. The ILM group is just part of the team, and they're able to tell me what they can and can't do. You are the ones that has to deal with the overall picture.
I'm for the visual effects acting as the DP.
So I'm concerned primarily with the technical and aesthetic issues of putting the shots together.
Yeah, yeah.
Rob is kind of the actors. George will direct Rob, and Rob will pass that on to his people.
We are no longer safe under their protection.
Perfect. Okay, print the last one. Be sure that the animation department gets that piece. And that's how we do it.
No matter what you do in motion picture medium, it's an exercise in utilizing resources and technology.
You know, the sphere is always this object of mystery. People want to know what is it, what the hell are you doing? It's a way of sampling lighting in a particular location to see how the whole scene is illuminated.
Whenever we're doing a digital character, we always do a block through with the voice actor and Ewan in this case, so that they can get the timing and pacing and where their eye lines are.
I don't care about these stinking eye lines. Who cares about eye lines?
Then we take the voice actor away, and he has to do the scene, pantomimes the scene.
The guy who's creating that character will create their responses off how you respond to their responses that aren't there. It's a nightmare.
That'll do nicely.
As we're setting up to shoot a shot, I try and project myself down the line. How are we going to actually execute this shot?
Flash.
Jason's been measuring all the camera positions, height relative to set, that if it turns out later on we need to shoot a matching element, we can recreate that camera position.
It's imperative that a match mover from ILM be on set to take set measurements and to place these track markers. Without a match mover, these track markers might not be in a shot, and it'll make it virtually impossible to recreate the camera move and to make a photorealistic environment.
A day to shoot, and probably for these shots, 4 or 5 months in post.
Once we get back to ILM, John and I would meet, and he and I'll just zip through the shots, and I'll say, okay, this shot's getting really close to animation, but I'm having some problems with getting the character interact with this table. Can you help out there? So there's a lot of back and forth.
Now, what do I do?
I go to ILM every Tuesday and Thursday morning, and I go over the work they're doing.
Locked out. Even I can't get past the security.
I go over on the computer the characters or the specific shots that they're working on.
The real breakthroughs, I think, with ILM were to take the strides and the inventions that have been created over the years and then try to streamline them and make them less expensive.
You have no idea what some of these things can look like or some of these things will be. So you just kind of, you know, get out there and act like everything's normal.
It's challenging because there's nothing there, but it's like theater in that way, you know. It's very demanding on the imagination.
I mean, when we started doing Star Wars, it was very hard to get a spaceship to fly and pan with it. Now it's just, we don't even think about it as so easy.
With the new digital technology and everything, I'm pretty much, whatever I can imagine, I can do. There are very, very few limits.
Because it's not really George Lucas, it's digital reconstruction of him.
It's all magic. I think there's a great deal in the psychological effect of a movie that comes from the soundtrack. So for me, the sound is very, very important. It's half the movie. I've always had the sound designer working on the picture from the very beginning. Ben Burtt created the sound for the laser sword that really affected how I approached the laser sword fight.
Fantasy like Star Wars requires the complete fabrication of a complete sound world, from footsteps to exploding space stations.
Ben's sounds, they're really unique, and he has just a great library of sound that he's worked with and great experience and great knowledge in that area of the artistic development of sound.
Matthew Wood worked on episode one
setting up the whole sound design workstation that I was to use. He was my mentor and teacher to get me started. As I, Rip Van Winkle, woke up in the future and sound had gone from the moviola analog audio to the Pro Tools and being digital.
I provide him raw sound effects elements. We're revving it to the next level with the film. Let's do it with sound too.
This is the only flying example of a Vickers Vimy in the world. This was the B-1 bomber of World War I.
Ben has a huge amount of plane recordings, and a lot of those plane recordings have actually ended up as spacecraft in the Star Wars universe. Just wanted to get it. He knew it was something unique that didn't exist everywhere. I just have all the major parts of the movie in my mind and what we need to record and what elements I can provide for Ben. Pretty amazing, huh? I'll get a takeoff and landing. And then I also want just a couple of bys. So while I'm there, if you could, you know, maybe just one or two just like going by me and then a circle. Could we do that? You know, you're going over me so I can get the Doppler effect of the, you know.
Okay.
Check. It's totally unique. They've got this giant wood propeller, so hopefully they're gonna oscillate in some way that's gonna sound unique. I'll try to get as many different types of sounds that it makes. That's amazing. And then all these metal struts here will be dragging in the wind. That can make a nice sound. If I just stay to those fence posts and walk about, you said a mile out there?
About a mile, yeah.
Yeah.
Brakes work on this thing now?
Yeah.
They do?
Sure. Brakes work good.
Are we ready? Anything unique we can get for the Star Wars movie. Hey, are we in a good location? I want to get him like right when he's leaving the ground.
The famous thing about this airplane, it's the first airplane to fly across the Atlantic Ocean nonstop, first airplane to fly from England to Australia, and the first airplane to fly from England to South Africa.
It does have a really interesting sound. It's like a giant car.
The best sounds are not things that you think of and imagine and then go out and search for, but rather discoveries you make.
Sound is happening all the time, so you're going to get something. But a lot of the stuff that you get is unexpected. Cool. The basic things that you always need to record, especially for the Star Wars movies, are like you need vehicles, you need passbys. Might be the bass sound, might be Obi-Wan's ship. No one is really going to be able to identify it as a plane, especially after Ben gets done tweaking it out.
The end result of a motion picture is a great combination of picture and sound working together to most effectively and dramatically tell the story.
Yeah, that was perfect. Yeah. I got a really interesting sound out of there, and it's gonna end up in the film, I bet. Cool.
You know, I think someday you're going to be able to probably do about everything we can do with models. You'll be able to do them in a computer, but we're not there yet.
It just takes longer at this point in time for them to build and finish a CG model than it does for them just to build one.
the constraints of building miniatures around a certain shot has just been blown wide open. We can do whatever we need to do to get the image, and then it can be doctored, altered, or touched up digitally.
The major shifts in visual effects since I've been in this profession, that's just incredible. I just turned around and suddenly we're in the computer world.
The models are used as a starting point, and then they have digital enhancements on top of them. So it's not like we just do the model and put it in the picture and it's done.
So we got one side, which we call a hero side of the model, which is where we spend all our time making things real nice.
Our miniatures are built with the filmmaking process in mind. We're not just building a piece of art, we're building something that needs to be photographed.
Because this will actually break into several sections for shooting, which pieces will be removable so cameras can get in and such.
You shoot them in various angles and things are what you need for the scenes, but you can actually pull them out and move them around and reconfigure them. Right. Terrific. Right.
I mean, it all just, you know, goes together like a jigsaw puzzle pretty quickly.
We have people who have very strong art backgrounds, and we have electricians, we have painters. You know, we're doing a lot of miniatures as environments, so George went ahead and shot all of his actors in front of blue screens, and we're creating the rooms that they're actually acting in. So this is a 10-scale miniature of the interior corridor. Here's the artwork we started with. So we have 100% miniature environment here, this hallway with Obi-Wan. That definitely sells it. Once a character goes into a model like this, it's a done deal, it's sold, and you really believe it.
And what you're seeing is all this is all the miniature stuff that we shot. And then the thing that you're missing here, because this is a shot in production, is all the digital stuff that goes in there that will change. But I don't think the shot will change. I mean, we've got that bug from George.
Whenever we change a shot, it's usually finished. It's really just a way of getting a lot of detail very fast without, you know, having to spend a huge amount of time on the computer to do it.
If the shot requires the camera to be, say, inside a room or inside an environment, the detail and level of model making needs to be exact and perfect. Sometimes it takes us a few tries to accomplish a perfect part. This one looks pretty good. You can see right here, there's a dimple in the piece that can really be highlighted and blow it. So the idea is no dust, perfect part.
We have model makers that know just how to make a model look like it's correctly aged and built and structured correctly and weighted. You know, it looks like a building has actually got the right weight to it.
There's no detail on this plane at all, but by breaking it up with paint and creating aging and drips, it's an illusion of a three-dimensionality to this part that doesn't exist.
We have a limited amount of resources, a limited amount of time, and then you build whatever you need to build to accomplish a shot.
In the computer world, all the computer guys will need to learn how to make the models, but also make them or be able to render them in time, especially organic shapes. But even a lot of architectural models is very time-consuming. And it's faster and better still to do a lot of work with models.
Boba Fett appears as a cartoon character. I think that's his first appearance, just after 78. The holiday special.
I am Boba Fett.
I think a great deal of fans, 98% of fans, want to know more about him.
I grow up in 4 and 5 and that, and then I become a bounty hunter. Whoa, I even get the jetpacks.
Rain as we can get, much wind as we can get.
One of the great things about episode 2 is it really delivers on this mysterious and wonderful character, Boba Fett, and also someone who's equally mysterious, the character called Jango Fett.
I guess he's the original bounty hunter then, because Boba Fett's like 11 years old in this one.
Come back on Monday, I think, to fly the spaceships. Can you do that? Fly through asteroids? Fight, shoot.
Took him under my arm. Call me Dad now, while we're here. Okay, I'll call you son, you know, just so we get the bit of bonding going.
We just gotta use our imaginations.
Actually, I think this is what fans have been waiting for ever since they saw Boba Fett in The Empire Strikes Back.
Bounty hunters.
And the very first day was a scene with all the bounty hunters. And all I was doing was just standing and looking at Darth Vader occasionally.
No disintegration.
As you wish.
I remember my younger son saying, isn't it funny you put a bucket over your head, Dad, and, and people think you're rather cool.
He's all yours, bounty hunter.
It was very exciting because the first real science fiction film I'd done.
Put Captain Solo in the cargo hold.
Human, yes. Origin, unknown. Planet, unknown. He was quite a special character. It's the mystery behind this uniform. You need to see the film several times to think, why does he wear this death head on his epaulette? They had little knee pads where I could fire darts with. They were Velcroed on. And by the end of the day, they'd obviously slipped round, so you'd have to keep shifting them. And if I walked, which I didn't do much of, they'd shoot across the room because the Velcro would snap off and fly. It wasn't easy.
Well, this is from Empire, and there's Boba Fett on set with his knee pads on upside down and his trousers rolled up. So when we first got the photos from the fitting and we put it next to, put them next to one another, you could see who it was meant to be.
Yeah.
But also you could see it was a different character, which is quite cool.
They used the Boba Fett costume for my costume as well. May the Force be with you, bro. We've gone for this new kind of silver millennium kind of color. Feels amazing and privileged to hold that mantle of the Boba Fett reign, you know? George. It's my lines today, George. Any dialogue?
You draw your guns and you pow, pow, pow.
The fight scene with Obi-Wan Kenobi. The space chase through asteroid planets. And the helmet, of course. And that got a bit much in the rain sometimes.
Believe me, this is rain. This is real rain.
Draw cameras.
You know, while you're doing your action and your fight scenes...
When the thing fogs up, I can't see anything. Oh, well, I'll just carry on like this. I can just see this blur coming down.
Being a strong, virile Maori warrior from New Zealand, well, you just got to deal with these elements and carry on. Thank goodness for those stunt doubles.
Good MC George, the director. Ask him about your motivation.
I love Boba Fett. I mean, we get to spend a lot of time with him in this movie. We get to understand where he comes from. But we also understand that, his identity is forged in some of the most powerful events that take place in the whole Star Wars saga.
But the biggest thing of all, he's pretty cool, yeah.
May the Force be with me.
It's awesome. It's even more powerful than what we see in Empire Strikes Back. I think people are going to be blown away, not only by the costume, but by the performance and the whole overall story that takes place between Jango Fett and Boba Fett.
It wouldn't rain up in space.
This is the heyday, the golden age of Jedi that exists in the world we have now. In episode 2,
I watched all these swashbuckling films all my life. You know, I was a huge Errol Flynn fan when I was a kid. And this seems to be the next step in the fencing age.
I mean, Jedi, as I've always said before, they've chosen a sword in a time of, you know, laser guns. So they better be damn good with it.
All right, all right.
All Jedi don't fight exactly alike.
An elegant weapon.
When we started, there was a particular style developed. It's a combination of samurai and Western sword fighting. And when we did Phantom, we sort of progressed that style.
You know, Nick Gillard creates a unique fighting style for each of the Jedi and how it sort of reveals a certain element of their personality.
All the Jedis have other ones, but that's the one, isn't it? And it's mine.
You have to distinguish between the characters, so you have to read the script a lot of times and understand the character.
A lot of the aggression that I hold in my character is exemplified in my fighting style.
He understands.
Yeah.
You know, he moves really well, he's tough.
Anakin maybe loses control a little bit and some of the darkness emerges, whereas a Jedi normally would have to be much more in control of the situation.
Roll, sir!
They're like marshals in the Old West. They're the keepers of the peace. They're given assignments to resolve conflicts.
This Jedi walks by and ruins my action.
With the ultimate threat of force if things aren't resolved.
I said, don't touch it. Yo, what?
Anakin, who's much more youthful, and I think Obi-Wan Kenobi's slightly more sedate.
Right. Oh, sorry.
He's much more confident now. It's 10 years or so past, I think. He's become the master, not the apprentice anymore.
Obi-Wan, his fighting style is much more by the book, even though he's obviously very skilled.
He has got extraordinary balance and hand-eye coordination. But yeah, it's a long process, and not just them getting the moves, but them keeping the character.
Getting the feet right and getting the steps so you can actually do it. It's a lot like dance choreography. Your feet have to be right so that the strikes look correct.
We're trying to go much more classical. You know, some of the characters are a real master swordsman, better than anything we've seen so far.
Excellent.
Trying to figure out who we had to talk to about your light color, your lightsaber color.
Oh, well, good guys are green and blue, bad guys are red. That's just the way it works.
No purple left?
You might get purple.
It would be a shame for me to participate in a film like this and never get to use my lightsaber.
We've not seen Mace fight yet, and we know that he's second only to Yoda.
Good to G.O.
I guess because I'm such a fan of Japanese samurai movies, and I've watched a lot of kendo fights and a lot of stuff, I'm doing pretty good at it.
I was thinking about the style for him, but it's Sam Jackson style, you know, that he has so much style of his own.
Since I'm supposedly the second baddest person in the universe, I'm pretty efficient. I don't do a lot of fancy sword twirling or anything. I dispense people pretty quickly. Use as little energy as possible, but I'm pretty lethal.
Okay, cool with that?
Yeah, I think this is the first time that we really get to see all the Jedi in action, which is an amazing sight.
But are you using the Force on the end there? Yeah, with him? Are you making him flop around like a dead fish?
No.
That set you going like...
No. No. That's his own thing. It's gas.
We're in the middle of this giant execution arena where there's thousands and thousands of Geonostians cheering and screaming as they are led to the wolves. You're trapped in an impossible situation with no means of escape.
Well, the arena scene in the picture starts out as an execution, and then it turns into a giant battle with Jedi. And then that turns into
the Clone War.
Real six, as we call it.
But there are only 100 Jedi available, and most of them were at Jedi resorts where we go and rest. We had to call them out.
There's 200 Jedi Knights who flooded into the arena fighting on the arena ground. To create that scene, we're filming each Jedi one at a time with two different cameras, so we can actually take the part of that fight that we like, and then we can actually composite them all together in one big fight where there'd be 100 of them all together in one shot.
A lot of it is that, more than the other kind of movie, this depends on trust. And if you don't quite know what's happening, you get, especially actors, get very nervous. Mm-hmm. You know, especially when there's nothing to hang on to. And I don't even know everything that's gonna be there until I actually start working on it.
It really is like a giant sketchbook, giving more of a, like a poetic, just general swath of the, you know, what is the feeling, the mood, the lighting, color, palette of the location.
The whole world of Geonosis is a combination of a kind of organic designed environment with a kind of tinge of industrial design in it.
Through the notes and direction and George's sort of trust in us exploring things, literally in the doodle sketchbook phase, we can quickly leap from a verbal concept to these color abstracts. George really was into the these termite-inspired towers, as if you know, they're great architects in the natural world. So by bringing in these tower elements, carving into the rocks, it shows an ancient society, very insect-like and very primal.
Poggle, something a little bit tougher than the average Geonosian. George presented them as a species that could just sort of disappear into the rock.
These ideas provide an inspiration and a conversation point for our meetings with George.
Once we've had those conversations about the Clone War, we're basically everything in the movie's covered.
Yeah.
And we're in it, in everything. There's nothing sort of sitting on the shore anymore. It was a giant arena where there was an execution, so it was very much, you know, like a Roman Colosseum in that guise of a spectator sport. We built this huge stadium.
During the ground battle, we'll use this. It'll be photographed and then replicated over and over again to help create the Geonosian landscape.
I think the camera move is going to start somewhere in here and use this corner as if the gunships have come out. They're coming around here, they're heading that way, and they're kind of flying past this piece, so the camera will come across this way.
Fabulous.
Fantastic. It's exotic, something we haven't done before.
So here we go.
Here we go.
300 some percent.
A whole reel.
Yeah.
The ability to be able to take anything that you can imagine and turn it into a completely photorealistic event where you can comp in any actor and it's seamless is really the dream that all of us have.
It's his point of view, so the camera would be right there. You see this edge.
Pretty tight then, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of sort of a waist shot.
Yeah.
Okay.
Shoot that, then we have a geography of what it is we're looking at in terms of backgrounds and whatnot. It's a giant exercise in having a vivid imagination. And the effect of 1,000 screaming termites.
Yeah.
That helps.
We've got
match moves that have come from the plates that they shot on live action. I can now key out the blue and then see what our characters look like when I'm first lining up the shot. So that as we pan or tilt or slide across the background, it's gonna match exactly what the characters are doing. Now we got a lot of close-up shots, and so we found that it would be faster if we just split the entire arena in half and then have one crew doing the opposite direction of the other crew. And that way we can get more stuff into post faster and get those shots coming out.
I think is probably the largest action sequence we have ever tried to even contemplate, much less achieve. We're very, very excited about it. It is so big.
Whether there'll be anything quite on this level in terms of a real six in the next film, but you know, it'll be more like Empire, where it's mostly just personal rather than grandiose.
That's what you said last time.
Well, I said this is a love story and it's not a...
Yeah, so there's going to be a lot fewer visual effects this time because it's a love story.
I lied, didn't I? To me, the sound is a very important part of the picture. It's not just an assembly line thing where you sort of cut the picture and then you just dump the sound on later. It's much more thought out than that.
The sound effects in Star Wars are really what gives these fantastic visuals credibility. And we just take for granted that these machines, these weapons, these aliens,
enjoy your stay.
These places are all real. But there always had to be someone selecting or creating the sounds that would be put into the soundtrack. And there's a real legacy there. The recordings live on. You know, we have over 5,000 sounds in the Star Wars library, and I've been recording things since about 1975. And I've kind of kept a mental record of the things we've recorded, kind of a living database, I guess. Quite often, I go back to the original tapes to find new material that we've never sampled before. But the stock is breaking down chemically. But we have found they can be resurrected if we place them in an oven, which warms the tapes up and will restore it so we can actually play it on one of our ancient quarter-inch tape machines. You have to learn to bake them correctly. If they're left in too long, you end up with this interesting piece of art, which used to be sound. I don't know. You can use these recordings as a inspiration sometimes for new things.
I've been working with Ben Burt, our sound designer, on episode 2 for the last couple of years. And he's the godfather of the Star Wars sound universe.
Make sure 6 is done in the first part of 8.
Most people don't realize all the different sound elements that make up a final soundtrack of a film.
It's pretty rough right now.
Like the Foley and the sound effects and the ADR and the production dialogue. And that process will take about a year before we get to the mix.
We're always on the alert for new sounds. And it's a 1942 gas air raid alert siren. It's disgusting. We collected a bunch of mechanical sirens, and that one was a real star. We took it and recorded it down in the parking garage so it really would echo. Now, we used this for the speeder's dive in the speeder chase. I love mechanical sounds, you know, things that are especially old devices, things that aren't, you just can't find them anywhere. One of the sounds we gathered was the Vickers Vimy biplane, which Matt went out and recorded. The sound of that airplane ended up being used for the sound of the gunships that are in the Clone War at the end of the film. Some of the sound of that biplane was I pitched it up and made it higher pitch sound out of it for the Geonosian fighters.
I'm the supervising sound editor. I provide him raw sound effects elements. The main thing when you're out recording is you're just going to look for something unique, something you hear, you haven't heard it before, and you grab it and you can use it for, you know, anything.
The droid factory sequence required practically every bit of machinery we've ever recorded. Machines that we recorded back as far as Empire Strikes Back, some metal stamping machines that were used. I found in the past that we've used almost every sound we've recorded by the end of the film. All of those bits and pieces were brought into the sound design room and reworked to create new sounds out of them. I always wanted to blend the literal with the non-literal. Always, we've made machine sounds, stamping, cutting, banging, the things you might expect with these machines. But this is a foreign alien world. What's to say it would sound like the Ford Motor Company? It should have some otherworldly quality to it. I'm constructing this mentally as I go, so it's sort of a intensive, it's composition. The idea of using percussion, musical sounds intermixed with the actual organic sounds of the machinery. So it'll be a little bit of a surprise, have some kind of dramatic freshness to it, than to be just what the audience may expect going in. So we're just gonna try it, and we can keep it separate, we can throw it away, we can use it. I just wanna have follow through on this idea. There's dialogue replacement because the set often can be very noisy. If Anakin and Obi-Wan are riding in the speeder, well, there's wind machines blowing on them. The track is just unusable. It's recorded, and then it uses a guide for the actors to come in and repeat their performances to get a clean and intelligible version of the dialogue.
Have they all left to come to the ADR session yet?
You call it Naboo, don't you?
Naboo.
Yeah, let me just do a wild take of struggles and I can cut that in.
It's not like she has dialogue, remember?
That's true.
It's not dialogue, it's just struggling.
It's just struggling.
Okay. Here we go.
A pair of lungs there.
Yeah.
No! No!
Beautiful.
That was good. Let's do one more for safety and.
Yep, well, that was good.
What's in a movie we do?
Exactly.
An action picture.
Here we go for take two. That was good.
That was great.
Yeah, I think we got that covered.
I hit the ship as well, aren't I? Yeah.
Yes, it's all part of the same thing. Here we go. Take one.
I hit the ship, but they used a decoy.
I got the sink on that one. That was great sink.
That was great,
that
too.
That was great.
Right. Happy?
That one's really happy. Good. I'm very happy for that one.
I want one more for safety, and I think we
what?
Got it. I'm sorry. I need one more.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I'm just, you know, I'm trying to look out for the... something.
You used to care.
I still care.
I hit the ship, but they used a decoy.
See, that's now I got so much more to work with. Okay, that was great.
You
I think I'm fine here. You made my night.
Okay.
You have the digital characters too, which you have to start from scratch.
Take three, buddy.
The Padawan is right, and only those who have turned to the dark side can sense the possibilities of the future.
On this film, we're going to record something like close to 900 lines of the dialogue.
Meditate on that. I will. Or I must.
Might as well get three in a row, right?
Beautiful. I think that's beautiful. I don't. That was take two or take one?
That was take two.
Yeah. Well, take two is the one. So, I think we've done it.
Yeah.
I think we can go home now.
Yeah.
May I present Lama Su, Prime Minister of Kamino. And this is Master Jedi.
Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Koya?
Hi.
Yes?
I'm just about done with spotting Lama Su here, so we're going to need to take this. This is the composite reel you gave me from the picture department. I don't have time to send anything FedEx. If you could put it up on our internet server for Sound Firm over in Sydney, so they'll have the same media we have, and then I'll just make sure that the tie line's working, which is going halfway around the world.
Okay.
How far away are they? 15,000 miles?
Yeah, something like that.
So the actor's in Sydney, and George and I are going to be in his theater in the main house.
Long distance looping.
The audio is going via ISDN. It's being encoded on both ends to sound CD quality. And then the video is actually, I've got duplicate video on both sides, and I'm just sending control information to both. So I'm not actually sending video.
Fett demanded only one thing, an unaltered clone for himself. Curious, isn't it? I have to hear it again.
Yeah, I think you had it, just you were just one beat too early.
Fett demanded only one thing, an unaltered clone for himself. Curious, isn't it?
Yes, that was really good for the whole thing.
This is the best we've ever had it in terms of the setup and the quality, and the ability to actually do it. And
yeah.
This works amazingly well considering that they're in Australia and we're here.
We tend to work with a smaller crew over a longer period of time compared to other feature films. We actually have a very small sound editing crew. We really did this film with two principal sound effects editors.
We have those elements of the metal, and then I'm going to add some dirt in. And then we still have these unrolling effects too, which are when the...
Bruce has been doing all the Geonosian crowds and all the crashes and impacts and, you know, that sort of thing. Terry's working on the lasers. I'm doing the creatures. Some poor person is going to have to do all the lightsabers.
Right. Who is that person?
Hiya, Terry. How are you? So what do we have today?
Do I hear the arena?
A little bit of it, sure. See how dense it is. No, that's not enough lasers. Wow. See, they'll probably be shooting in those marching shots. You know, I just don't know. But that's great. There'll be more lasers in this than ever before in any Star Wars movie. Density.
I think so.
Very good. So I'm off to my next round. Keep up the good work.
Foley are the sound effects that are really too specific to be found in a library.
I got the dippity-doo and the chamois.
Yeah, I'm gonna bring this over.
We'll spot the scenes with the Foley department, and they will go through like an old radio play and perform them like with props. And the Foley editors will then put that in exact sync with the picture, and we'll mix it down as part of the effects track.
There was some really excellent Foley sounds done by Denny Thorpe and Jana Vance for the Calhouns crawling across the floor.
Give it a go. Thank you.
If it's asteroids exploding and, you know, rocket ships flying by, that wouldn't be us. We carry the reels that have a lot of people that are moving and walking and doing stuff.
It just gives an added level of realism to the scene, especially if you're dealing with digital characters that have no sound whatsoever.
Yeah, that's really good.
That's awesome.
Nice job recording too, Pat.
Yeah. That one was not so good.
Maybe let's make them like a little parting, because there you can see that they're still together, and uh-huh. then they're going to come back together, and then we'll get another one.
But we got to make it sound, you know, passionate. Right.
Okay, we're all set.
Let's let her rip.
Can't rip anymore. It's not film.
Oh, yeah, that's good. Ben, you're sweating.
Is that an elbow kiss or a forearm kiss or?
You have to kind of know what you're doing with your hand.
Okay, I don't want to know.
It was great.
Yeah.
Thanks, you guys.
All right. Let's go to the next thing. Right now, I'm just trying to create some buzzy, insecty kind of sounds out of actual speech. We started out speaking English, and then we slowly changed it word at a time. And then we started talking through the edge of a piece of paper, making a buzzy sound. I start cutting it up in little pieces and changing the speed, make it so it's too fast. You know, you could never say it this way live. We talked about the idea that since Poggle apparently has two mandibles, he has an up and down and a side to side, like a grasshopper. And that if I make this sort of buzzy thing, he would go, he would just kind of do that with a funny little animation with part of his mouth talk.
It's important that this be articulate like this, because I think it is reasonably articulate.
I mean, this is the most organic in terms of it's not pitch changed or anything, so there's no electronic aspect to it.
He said, "We have no choice but to order our treat."
Uh-huh. Okay, he's more emphatic about it.
So he's much more emphatic about it. But it means you should really see it. As long as you keep not going on simultaneously.
Right.
Like they butt against each other, a word can form into that. It sounds great.
Yeah, it's good. It's the last voice in the whole film right now for me. From here on in, it's just a giant mix.
Can't believe we're here finally. My job is to work with the editors to make sure that we get all the elements of the film, like the foley, the sound effects, the replaced dialogue, the production dialogue, and the sound design, and to make sure that they get all of those elements into sync with the most current picture, and then we bring that to the mix.
The final mix lasts for about a month on a Star Wars film. We go into a dark room every day, and we listen to every sound and every bit of music and every bit of dialogue, and we inch our way through each scene, sometimes only completing a few minutes a day. He can immediately decide whether he, you know, wants some major changes of some sort, often tearing things apart and putting them back together a different way until we find something that really satisfies us all and will satisfy George Lucas.
Gary and Ben are in charge. There isn't anybody else who has any power over here.
The first day of the final is always unknown. You never know what's going to happen until you start running it all together. The whole problem is that we haven't heard. Michael's done the dialogue. He hasn't really heard everything that we've done in effects. We haven't heard the music at all, so
it all... Throw it all into the pot right off the bat and then sort it out.
Sometimes it's a surprise how it all sounds together.
It's kind of like brainwashing in a way. You go in, you're in the dark, there's loud sounds, there's one source of light on you.
The pop.
Boop! Oh, everybody stood up to attention. You hear things over and over and over again.
Yeah, be careful with their little squeaky sounds. Little chirpy chipmunk sounds. Yeah, there's some great foley in here, but I guess you don't have foley, do you? There's a little cutie stuff in there. I think it's too close to what R2 does, and it's also...
I think that is R2. It's R2 sleeping off screen. He's snoring.
Well, and get rid of it.
He's paid by the beep, George.
Yeah, he jabbers.
R2 was lost, and I hope he's not too disappointed. But it happens to all of us. We do things that get cut out of the movie, you know? I've done a million things that are cut out of the movie, so.
It would be nice if we could record for you know, that guy that almost runs into Obi-Wan, not the two guys, but the first guy.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Maybe you should say, what the? It's a traditional line. It's in all the movies, and that'd be a good place for it, I think.
What the?
I love that horn.
Oh, the beep beep. The Tucker.
Well, now we got reel one done. Now what do we
do? Can you prep reel two, please?
Well, good luck. Take two aspirin, call me in the morning.
Minor details, they add up to things. They can add up to significant changes if you do enough of them. Coming right up here, it's like that and that.
So what I'm doing now is a welding, which is, I think, going to take a while.
Yeah, I know. Well, I'm not rushing you.
I'm just thinking
checking
ahead.
In.
Good morning, Mr. Burt. Cookies. Who's got cookies?
Okay. I guess we're on effects.
I think, you know, it needs to be more like chattering, you know, like crying. And that kind of stuff, not this kind of.
Can we borrow that microphone for a second?
Wait till you hear the droid factory. There's a real collision of.
A cacophony of craziness?
Of movie styles coming
it's
together.
What do you think about this?
it's a tough one.
I just don't think the percussion is strong enough to withstand what's going on in there. I think we should just replace the percussion part with effects.
In actuality, some of the musical sounds that I had made for the droid factory, the drums and things like that, were dropped, but the idea was sort of reborn in the monster fight. Rhythmic sounds that acted as a response to events on the floor of the arena. Horns, as if it was a sports, wild sports crowd blowing horns and chanting. Kinds of things that we immediately associate with the emotions of a giant crowd in a stadium. It was a good trade, actually. Because that's the nature of making these films, that you can always change something, and there's always you can revisit a scene and evaluate it one more time. It's an ongoing process that is really only brought to the end by the calendar.
I don't know whether I should bring it up now, but I guess I should. Yeah. I had a rather, this is just an aside, which will probably cause you a lot of angst, but we're almost done, so I can't do this anymore. It's back in Palpatine's office. The little hologram comes on, right. And he says, good, we'll deal with this later. Send them in.
Yeah.
That should really be good, send them in, we'll deal with this later. See what you can do.
I'm going to cook up some, cook up the words.
Good. Send them in. We will discuss this matter later.
I don't think so.
What is this sound?
I'm not going to tell you. Actually, it's arcing. It's electrical arcing.
25 years ago.
Yeah. Just seems like it's not good enough. There's always a point toward the end during the final mix that I can actually sit down and address the absolute final details, and it adds what I would say the final accent to a moment in the film. During the asteroid chase, which is basically a sound effects only sequence, it was hard to come up with a sound for the seismic charge that would have dramatic contrast to every sound that had just preceded it. It didn't occur to me until we were in the final mix, struggling with this problem, that the best solution might be to have no sound. I reasoned that all energy was pulled into it. No sound could escape. And it was only after it had detonated that somehow the energy was released, and then the sound occurred. I created what I call
an audio black hole. Certainly at this point, it's just going to be these minor details that are changing. It will shape the reels all together as if it was final, and then play it for him again, and he'll decide.
Understand that it basically creates a vast amount of havoc at this end if you make changes after the mix.
Yes, it's a little complicated. It's inevitable, George. You've done it every time. Yeah, it's you know. What would it be without a sync change in 7? We wouldn't feel right. Every filmmaker feels that as long as there's time,
couple of shots,
there's something they can do to improve the movie.
New animation or something?
Well,
or
no, we made some changes on the Monica one, and they hadn't gotten into the deluxe one because they were trying to go so fast.
Uh-huh.
But I said, no, go back and make it right before you make the printing masters. You know, there's a reason why we improve a shot.
Right. And then it's just traditional to work until someone just takes it away from you. You know, films are not released, they escape.
It's amazing.
I know.
It is. It's amazing incredible. To see it.
I know, sure. That was the first time through the whole movie.
Yeah, it's like, this is normally what people get to see at the first rough cut screening.
Yeah, I know. I can't look at it and just sort of think of all the hours.
You know, just that we've lived with this for 2 years.
And
it's a matter now of meeting or not meeting expectations. That's that whole factor you can't predict.
Hey, we're beyond that now. We've finished it. It's a movie. We've done it. We did it. We did our part.
Must be difficult having sworn your life to the Jedi. Not being able to do the things you like.
Or be with the people that I love.
Episode 2 is George's first real romance movie. It's still got, you know, all of the classic Star Wars elements. I've got a lot of battles and stuff, but the story is really centered around this love story between Anakin Skywalker and Senator Amidala.
In the earlier films, episodes 4, 5, and 6, there is a little kind of flirtation, but it's never carried very far. Obviously, Han Solo and Leia fall in love with each other.
You like me because I'm a scoundrel. There aren't enough scoundrels in your life.
I happen to like nice men.
But that isn't the sort of core of the story, and it takes place over 3 movies. This one, it's a much more condensed love story. There's still a lot of action and war. It's sort of a love story against the backdrop of a war.
When George first began to speak to me about episode 2, when George said to me, why don't you make a love theme? It's like the old Hollywood movies. It's introduced gradually when the lovers are reunited, not as lovers, but as acquaintances in the beginning of the film.
Anakin has been in love with Padme ever since he was 10 years old.
Are you an angel?
You know, he worshipped her when he was young, and now they're finally getting back together.
You're sweating. Relax. I haven't seen her in 10 years, Master.
When he first sees Padme, his attraction changes from when we first saw their relationship and how it left. It was a much more childlike affection.
Annie? My goodness, you've grown.
So have you. Grown more beautiful, I mean. Well, for a senator, I mean.
And he'll always be that little boy I knew on Tatooine.
Padme just thought of him as a little kid. So it's Padme adjusting to the fact that he's now a grown-up guy.
Sometimes we must do what is requested of us.
You've grown up. And all of a sudden he comes back and she's like, wow, you know. He's grown up into this handsome young Hayden Christensen. So their relationship really goes from this sort of her looking down on this younger guy to him sort of proving himself as a real force.
You are a
Danny, it is you! A Jedi, what do you know?
Actually, the undercurrent of the whole love theme is very touching, very sweet, and it's more like courtly love.
You're making fun of me.
No, I'd be much too frightened to tease a senator.
We have a much more romantic story, so that Padme's costumes are obviously more sultry in nature.
As George sort of progressed with the script, he sort of realized more that he wanted to show a softer, sort of friendlier side to Padme, where she could be looking sexy and gorgeous and young and in skimpy clothes.
I think the biggest difference is that I shot a bit more skin in this one. This is my sexed up version, I guess, of the Queen. I got over the hump of 18, so I'm allowed to show tummy now, I guess.
There's romance for, you know, the kids who love romance stories, young girls. Young girls will be in love with Hayden, and you know, the guys are gonna be excited because Anakin's character's exciting, Obi-Wan's character's exciting.
Escort the senator back to Naboo. She'll be safer there.
They have to travel together a lot because he's protecting her because someone's trying to assassinate her.
Don't do anything without first consulting either myself or the council.
Yes, master.
He's constantly telling the Jedi Order that Anakin's not ready to be sent off on an assignment on his own. He says that his abilities have made him arrogant.
Excuse me. I'm in charge of security here, m'lady.
That's not a good thing to be, and it's dangerous. And then they don't listen to him. And we all know what happens in the end.
Throughout the film, you know, they're put in these very extreme settings because they're in hiding that really lend themselves to, you know, falling in love. And they're spend a lot of time in a lakeside palace or in, you know, grassy fields, and it's really conducive to two people finding very passionate emotions for each other.
So then they sort of have these encounters where they discuss their ideas and they discuss their, you know, lives, and he's trying to show off to her all the time, you know, probably in ways that he's not allowed to, you know, using sort of his Jedi tricks.
Padme is a very strong-willed person. You know, he's not so much attracted to the power that she holds in her political arenas, but rather the power and strength that she holds within herself. She's very beautiful and intelligent, and it would be easy for anyone, I think, to fall in love with her.
Padme is attracted to Anakin mainly for his looks. I mean, let's be honest. He allows her to be a little less serious about herself and laugh a little and, you know, fall in love.
The love story is a very classic love story of forbidden love. Two people who fall in love with each other when they really can't do that.
We could keep it a secret.
We'd be living a lie. I couldn't do that. Could you, Anakin?
It's a star-crossed set of lovers, really, where the lovers are separated by class or by family, as they are in Romeo and Juliet, or by rank, as they are in Episode II.
Be mindful of your thoughts, Anakin. They betray you. You've made a commitment to the Jedi Order, a commitment not easily broken.
He understands that as a Jedi, he's not allowed to fall in love, even though he feels so passionately for Padme, and it's this sort of, these conflicting emotions.
Well, there are Jedi rules, you know, and one of them is that you don't fall in love, and he breaks those rules.
He feels very passionately about becoming a great Jedi, but at the same time, he feels so passionately for Padme, and it's that confusion that really causes him all of his anxiety.
It's the same struggle for Padme. She's the sort of the more mature one, the more rational one, the one that's not letting her emotions run away with her.
It's really a struggle for her to say, you know, can I be selfish and fall in love myself when I have all these aspirations and all these things I need to accomplish?
So it's the struggle to sort of maintain some sanity in the overwhelming wave of chaos brought about by love.
He's holding me back!
You have a sense with Anakin that there's a dark side to him, and his dark side already clouds the relationship.
He does have an edge. He's got a sort of a James Dean sullen edge to him.
She sees this sort of darkness to him, but obviously that's always intriguing. Girls always like the bad boys.
The anger is a product of his confusion. He's very passionate about the path that he wants to take as a Jedi. You know, he's very determined and he feels like he's being held back. He wants to break free of that, but then at the same time, you know, he's found this love in his life, which takes him in a completely different direction.
The idealistic, sunny aspect, hopeful aspect of what we feel is balanced by the sense that experience gives us that these relationships never quite work out the way we idealize them. And something will happen to tilt it.
If evil can love, then what is evil? If, you know, love is what makes you human, and then is someone who is evil human still? I mean, it just makes all the questions involving the film a lot more complex.
You know, they fall in love, and the struggle is whether they should allow this to happen to their lives, even though they know it's going to be very destructive. You know, in the end, they do decide to give in to their emotions, and ultimately they will suffer all the consequences of that. Episode 2 takes place 10 years after Episode 1, and now Anakin is a Padawan learner, apprentice Jedi, and Obi-Wan is his mentor. Padme finished her term as the Queen of Naboo and has gone on to become a senator. The movie is essentially a story about Anakin and Anakin's dealing with his emotions, the difficulty of his being torn between his duty and his emotional needs which relate to Padme.
Must be difficult having sworn your life to the Jedi, not being able to do the things you like.
Or be with the people that I love.
Are you allowed to love? Thought that was forbidden for a Jedi.
It's the beginning of the end of democracy in the Republic. We go to Kamino, which is a very exotic, more fantastic, science fiction-y kind of planet. Very surreal. And we also go to Geonosis, which is a planet of insect-like creatures.
In terms of the scope, visually, the amount of planets, the vehicles that have been designed for this, this is the most ambitious of all the various chapters that have been made already.
This is back to the spirit of adventure, the excitement, the drama. Everything is in this script that made people fall in love with the original Star Wars.
Since Episode 1, he'll have been training Anakin heavily.
Patience. Use the Force. Think.
Sorry, Master. They're like two old friends who've been together a long time and who spend too much time together.
You know I don't like it when you do that.
Sorry, Master. I forgot you don't like flying.
Well, you've lost him.
If you'll excuse me.
I hate it when he does that.
Obi-Wan Kenobi's worried Anakin's a bit headstrong and overconfident.
Boy has exceptional skills.
But he still has much to learn, Master. His abilities have made him, well, arrogant.
He loves Obi-Wan because he is sort of a father figure for him. But at the same time, there still is that resistance because Anakin does want to break free of what he's doing right now.
I'm ready for the trials, but he feels that I'm too unpredictable. He won't let me move on.
She is now a senator. She had been the queen, but her reign ended, and the new queen asks her to stay and help out and be a senator, so she's still in the political scene. Do you have any idea who is behind this attack?
We will find out who's trying to kill you, Padme. I promise you.
Escort the senator back to Naboo. She'll be safer there.
They have to travel together a lot because he's protecting her.
Throughout the film, they're put in these very extreme settings because they're in hiding.
You're making fun of me.
No, I'd be much too frightened to tease a senator.
She really struggles with sort of the career versus romance issue.
You're studying to become a Jedi? I'm a senator.
We could keep it a secret.
We'd be living a lie. I couldn't do that. Could you, Anakin?
He understands that as a Jedi, he's not allowed to fall in love. Even though he feels so passionately for Padme, it's that confusion that really causes him all of his anxiety.
This one, obviously, we kind of know what happens to Anakin. We just don't know how and why.
It's all Obi-Wan's fault. He's holding me back.
You're not all-powerful, Anakin.
Well, I should be.
Anakin's flaws, like all classic mythological heroes, are the flaws that everyone carries with them. The issues that he's confronting is that a good Jedi overcomes those flaws and kind of goes above the normal human tragedy that most people have to experience.
What is it?
Pain, suffering, death, I feel.
Anakin is starting to display some interesting characteristics that need to be watched closer.
Evil isn't just pure evil. A lot of times it comes from good. Episode 2 is sort of like an extended portrayal of how evil evolves.
And it really allows you to, I think, feel for his struggle much more. And I think that most people would make some of the same choices that Anakin does.
It's no different than having somebody in your family that you love who's got a serious problem. There's not much you can do. You don't stop loving them. And I think that's what's going to happen, especially with somebody as good as Hayden.
Cut.
I go on a kind of Dick Tracy detective spree. I've always wanted to have my own ship, and he gets one, and he gets to take off on his own adventure on this one. A bit like Luke Skywalker does in his X-Wing when he goes to find Yoda.
They are using a bounty hunter named Jango Fett to create a clone army.
Wait. Your clones are very impressive. You must be very proud.
They'll do their job well.
I needed a Jedi who was an older Jedi that had left the Order, who was very good. I decided to go with a more elegant, sophisticated kind of person, reminiscent of Obi-Wan Kenobi as an older man.
I play a character called Count Dooku, a battle-scarred Jedi. He's obviously a man of immense power, mental power and physical power.
You must join me, Obi-Wan, and together we will destroy the Sith.
Commerce skills are preparing for war, there can be no doubt of that.
My role apparently is that of mediator, who believes in peace and the power of negotiation until it seems that it's absolutely inevitable and nothing else can be done.
I will create a grand army of the Republic to counter the increasing threats of the Separatists.
This is actually the beginning of the Clone War, so there's a lot of intense action sequences in this film. This is the heyday, the golden age of Jedi. We see Jedi in large battle scenes, you know, battling as a large group. And before, we've never seen that before. There's always been a couple of Jedi fighting each other.
It's a bigger part, and I do more things in it. That just means that I have to work a little harder, making sure I stay alive for the next one.
I look at these as the swashbuckling adventures of the modern era. To work on a film that has the scope of the Star Wars, you know, saga, it's kind of like a dream come true for an actor, because you're doing something that you know is going to last forever.
What more can an actor want in terms of being in a story which is immortalized in the eyes of millions of people? It's very rewarding, very enthralling. And it's magic.
I think people like seeing, you know, themselves in a fantastical world. It's really like a fun trip for the imagination.
It's just the story of people wanting to break free from their surroundings and reach new ground. the struggle from, you know, the good side and the dark side, and something that we all deal with that, which I guess is a theme in all of the Star Wars movies.